Hello friends, myself Neha Gupta, your mentor for current affairs. So a very delightful and prosperous Happy New Year to all of you. And this is the first day of this new year. Therefore, in order to start your day with some productive activity, I have brought up this series of Morning Tales for January 1st, 2021, in which I will be discussing a lot of interesting current affairs. So let's begin. But the students who are coming for the first time can subscribe and hit this bell notification. Also, you can join this Telegram group where you can enjoy the free quizzes as well as you can resolve your queries. So here we are at our first question. Where is the highest meteorological center in India located? So recently, Indian Meteorological Department has established the meteorological center, which is India's highest meteorological center. Highest in the sense that it is located at a height of 3,500 meters. So, in that manner, it is the highest meteorological center in India. Now, where is it located? So, it is located in Leh, Ladakh. So, the right answer is option A. Now, a surprising or I would say a unique thing about this meteorological center is that it is the second center in the Himalaya region after the one that we have in Itanagar, Arunachal Pradesh. So, we only have two meteorological centers to predict the weather conditions and prevent weather mishappenings in the Himalayan region. So one is in Arunachal Pradesh and the second is in Ladakh. So that much for this question only. But my question for you is the chief of IMD. So do tell me in the comment section below. Next question is, where is India's first pollinator park located? So this sounds interesting that India has its first pollinator park, and a surprising or I would say an interesting thing here is that a total number of 40 species of pollinators are present in this park. Now where is it located? So it is in Uttarakhand. Now guys, since Uttarakhand has many firsts in this year, in the last year I would say, so in 2020, many firsts were attached to this state. Therefore, I have picked out the important information, static information related to this state in this video. So let's have a sneak peek into the state of Uttarakhand. So this is going to be a very interesting ride for all of us, where we will be discussing about the state language or the various state icons of Uttarakhand. So first we have the state language. Official state language is Hindi. Flower is Brahma Kamal. State bird is Himalayan Monal. Tree is Budanas. Butterfly is Papilio Bionaut, which is also named as common peacock. State animal is white-bellied musk deer. Now, this is the most interesting part of this entire journey of Uttarakhand. Where we have the GI tag of Uttarakhand. So do remember this thing. It is Tejpatta. Only Tejpatta from the Uttarakhand has this GI tag. Folk dances are Pandav Nritya, Bhotia dance, Cholia dance, Jhora dance and Mukhota dance. Now, as I mentioned that there were many firsts attached to Uttarakhand in the year 2020. So what are those firsts? India's first moss garden, India's first snow leopard conservation center, and India's first lichen park, along with India's first pollinator park. So these are some of the firsts that are there in Uttarakhand. Therefore, all these four important centers, I would say, make Uttarakhand a very important state for your examination. So do pay attention to the static facts related to the state of Uttarakhand. Now, guys, let's discuss some facts related to the territory of Uttarakhand or the rivers, lakes, dams and national parks, wildlife sanctuaries and biosphere reserves. So here in this slide, you can see I have a mammoth list of rivers, lakes, dams and sanctuaries. So here you can take a screenshot of this slide or pause the video and read out the names on your own. And do remember this thing that you have to memorize these things as well, because these are static GK facts. So you have to remember the national parks, wildlife sanctuaries, biosphere reserves, important dams, lakes and diverse of the state of Uttarakhand. So I hope that you have come to know various interesting facts related to the state of Uttarakhand, but do not forget to memorize some facts related to the state. So now we are on our next question, and let's discuss that question. Who heads the committee formed by Department of Science and Technology to use futuristic and new age technologies for conservation of Indian heritage? Quite an easy question it is. A committee has been formed by the Department of Science and Technology. And what is the purpose? The purpose is to conserve Indian heritage. How Indian heritage will be conserved? By using the futuristic or new age technologies. Now, who heads this committee? So, the committee is headed by the director of IIT Jodhpur. Now, who is that person? Do you know this thing? It is Shantanu Chaudhary. Remember that he is the director of IIT Jodhpur. So here this question ends. Which of the following organization has developed India's first indigenous ruthenium-106 plague technique for treating eye cancer? So I know that this term would be looking like a very complex term. Yes, it is. It is a medical term, and we are not required to indulge into the meaning of this term. So let's restrict ourselves to the news itself. And the news is that a center from the options has developed this India's first indigenous technique that will treat the eye cancer, and the cancer is particularly named as ocular tumors. So this eye cancer will be treated through this technology. Now, which center has developed this technology? So it is option E, Bhabha Atomic Research Center. It seems like an odd one out situation, because Bhabha Atomic Research Center does not have any direct connection to the medical field. But yes, guys, it is true that this technology has been developed by this Bhabha Atomic Research Center and not any one of these institutions which sound very familiar to the medical field. But it is true. So do remember this thing, that this Bhabha has developed this technique. Now our next question is very important. So what is the name of the portal launched by Ministry of External Affairs to connect with Indian diaspora? So a new portal, as well as the application with the same name, has been launched by the Ministry of External Affairs. What is the name? So I would like to read out the options here so that you can easily connect with the, or you can guess the name. So Pravasi Rishta, Pravasi Gatbandhan, Pravasi Suhaat, Pravasi Sambandh, Pravasi Samjhota. What is the right answer? So the right answer is Pravasi Rishta, Global Pravasi Rishta. So this is the name of the portal as well as the app that has been launched by Ministry of External Affairs. Now what is the purpose? The purpose is threefold. First purpose is to connect the Ministry of External Affairs and the Indian embassies with the diasporic people. Who are diasporic people? The people who are residing outside India. That is the first purpose, that is to establish communication link between the Ministry of External Affairs, embassy, and the diasporic people. So I would like to write it here, communication. Second purpose is to facilitate registration of non-resident Indians, person of Indian origin, or the overseas citizens of India. So these are three categories in which diasporic people are categorized by the Indian government. And this portal will help the people who belong to any of these categories to register themselves. So that is a way, an easy way out for the diasporic people to register themselves and obtain the status of either of them, non-resident Indian or PIO or OCI. Third purpose is to create awareness about the government schemes, so that the diasporic people can also get the information related to these existing and the new government schemes that are being launched, that will help them in help them in any way or for information purpose only as well. So these are the threefold purposes that this Pravasi Rishta portal aims to serve. So that's all for this question. And now we are moving on to the next question. So recently, Ministry of Finance has mandated businesses with monthly turnover of over 50 lakhs to mandatorily pay at least 10% of their GST liability in cash. So this, first of all, why has such a step been taken by the Ministry of Finance when we are promoting digital payments, digital transactions and moving towards a cashless economy? The very purpose is to curb the frauds that are taking place in the name of invoices. So basically, people or businesses are making fake invoices to take the advantage of input tax credit, and therefore, in order to curb that thing, this percentage, a certain percentage of their GST liability has to be paid in cash. Now, what is the percentage? It is 1%. So 1% of the total GST liability of the businesses with turnover over 50 lakhs has to be paid in cash. So do remember this threshold as well as this threshold, 50 lakhs, because the question can come up on this thing as well. So here this question ends and the session as well. So I hope that this new year brings a lot of happiness for you and becomes productive for you. Thank you so much for watching this video, and if you have liked it, then do share it and do give us a thumbs up. Thank you.